So we've seen how we can store individual values inside of variables. But life isn't always about an individual item. Sometimes you're going to have a group of items. And sometimes we want to be able to store them in just like a single column. Sometimes we want to be able to store them into a group where we can actually give each one a name. And that's what we're going to take a look at here in collections, where we'll introduce the concepts of lists, arrays, and dictionaries. Well, let's start with a list. A list is just simply a collection of items. So you'll notice that we've declared a variable called names, and we've set it equal to, using square brackets there, let me go ahead and grab my highlighter, so square bracket right there, and a square bracket right there, we've set that equal to be both Christopher and Susan. Just simply put a comma between them, and away you go. And if I were to call print, you'll notice that Python will just simply print out the values that are inside of there. Now, one thing I want to highlight is that even though I've used strings, I can actually use any data type that I might want. So if I maybe have a collection of return values that I might have gotten from some external service or numbers or who knows what, I can absolutely store all of those inside of a list. Now, what happens if maybe you don't know the values in advance? Maybe you're going to be pulling them in programmatically through an input statement, performing some other calculations, or otherwise. Well, in that case, you could actually just start with an empty list, just like I have right up here. So now I've got nothing inside of there, so now I could just start adding items to the end by calling append. Now, again, in my case, I've gone ahead and just put in numbers, just for simplicity's sake, but if I was calling something external, maybe using input, all of that would work just fine. And again, if I call print, it will just print out just like we saw before. But I do want to highlight the fact that we can access individual items inside of a list by using an indexer. Now, if I say scores, and then that's square brackets of one, what it's actually going to give me back is the second value. The reason for that is because everything in Python is going to be zero indexed. So all counting starts with zero. Python also has arrays. Now, in order to use an array, it's slightly different syntax. You'll notice that we have to import in our arrays. We saw this a little bit with date time, and we'll talk a bit more about this later on, but that allows me to get in my array. And then what I do is I declare the type of array that I want. In my case here, I'm declaring an array of digits. And that's what that D stands for. If you check out the GitHub repository for this course, you'll actually notice there's a link to the documentation where you can go in and see all of the possible values for all the possible data types that you can put into an array. Now, you'll notice from here, the code winds up being basically identical. I want to add numbers? Fine, just call append. I want to print? Fine, just call print. And if I want to access an individual item? Fine, just go ahead and use the exact same indexer, and I get the exact same results. Just some slightly different formatting things, just because that D is actually going to be floating point. And you might be wondering at this point, well, wait a minute, Christopher. Then what's the difference between an array and a list? Well, an array is designed for simple types, such as numbers, and all the items inside of there have to be of the exact same type. A list, on the other hand, can actually store any type of item that you might want, which is why I've actually represented it with a shopping cart. You can kind of think about it that way. You just toss whatever it is that you might want inside of there, and it's going to then keep the list of all of those different items. You'll find in most of the code that you're going to be writing that you'll be working with lists, unless you start getting into a lot more machine learning. Then when you get in and start programming your own ML models, you'll find yourself quite frequently working with larger types of arrays there. Now, what else can we do with arrays besides find individual items? Well, we can go ahead and grab the length of an array by calling len. We can call insert and specify where we want to put something inside of an array. And in this case, it's going to wind up going in just before the index that we specify here. So since I specified 0, it's going to go at the very beginning. And then last but not least, I also have the ability to call sort, which in my case here is going to wind up doing it alphabetically. So when we run this, you'll notice that it will tell us that we have two items to start because we didn't insert Bill in. Then when I call insert and then I put in Bill, it's going to put it at the very beginning. And then finally, when we call sort, you'll notice that it will automatically do this in alphabetical order. The last type of, the last main operation that we want to highlight with a list or an array is to get just a subrange. And the way that we do that is by indicating this syntax right here of that 0:2. There's two parameters. The first parameter, let me grab my pen here, this is where we want to start. So we're going to start at the very beginning. That's our 0. The second one is how many items are we going to grab? So in our case, we're going to grab two items from the beginning. And so now, if we take a look at our presenters here, which is that second list, what you're going to notice because of the fact, let me make sure that I've got my pen. Now I do. Because of the fact that we grabbed that as the subarray, and when we print that out, you'll notice that it just gives us the first and the second items there. We start at 0, start with the first item, and then grab the next two. And so that allows you to grab just a smaller set of values that might be inside of a list. Okay, now the last type of collection that we want to take a look at is a dictionary. Now, if we take a look at the syntax for setting up a dictionary, you'll notice that this very closely resembles JSON if you're familiar with JSON or JSON. If you're not familiar with JSON, don't worry. We actually have a module coming up a little bit later where we'll talk about it. Now, with a dictionary, what we're going to have is key value pairs. So we'll have a key of first and a value of Christopher. And then we'll go ahead and add on another value with a key of last and then a value of Harrison. You'll notice that we could print out the entire dictionary. And you'll also notice that if I want to go grab an individual item, that I can do this by using the name rather than by using the index. And so the eventual result here when I print this out is it's going to tell me first Christopher, last Harrison, and then you'll notice that when we just called person first, that it's just going to print out Christopher. You might be wondering, okay, well, when should I use a dictionary and when should I use a list? Well, in both cases, I can put in whatever values it is that I might want. The big advantage that a dictionary gives to me is it gives me a set of key value pairs. So if I need to be able to go in and find a specific item, and I don't necessarily remember the order of it, that's perfect for a dictionary. Or sometimes just the ability to name something is exactly what you're looking for. Again, you'd be looking for a dictionary. Now, if I want to be able to access it based on a numerical index, or I need to guarantee the order of all of those items, that's where a list comes into play. So with a list, everything's going to be number indexed, and it's going to guarantee the order of items that go in and the order of items when I go to pull them all back out. Let's get in and take a look at some code samples for our lists and for our dictionaries.